Chapter 16. I know a couple of weeks ago I stated that last week would have been the end of our study. However, we're in a section that is so important, and I honestly don't want to rush through it. I really want to do a better job in looking at some of these details, okay, as we're at the very end here in the book of Romans. So we're going to go back to verse 25, chapter 16, Romans chapter 16, and we're going to read verses 25 through verse 27. And we're going to pick up where we left off last Sunday morning. We're looking at Paul's commendation here and how it is he's releasing the Romans and obviously releasing all of us as members of the body of Christ to the edification design, okay? Romans chapter 16, verse 25, "Now to him that is of power to establish you according to my gospel and the preaching of Jesus Christ, according to the revelation of the mystery, which was kept secret since the world began, but now is made manifest, and by the scriptures of the prophets, according to the commandment of the everlasting God, made known to all nations for the obedience of faith, to God only wise be glory through Jesus Christ forever. Amen." Here's this edification design. We're dealing in the context with a properly established believer. That is, we are firmly fixed and grounded so that we can now resist and oppose the satanic policy of evil and the tactics that are intended to get us to move away. And we've said so much thus far. So last time we looked at the issue of my gospel, highlighting how it is Paul has ownership of this system of revelation. When he calls it my gospel, by the way, Paul is the only one in the Bible that ever uses that language. He never says the gospel. He refers to it as my. Again, ownership. It belongs to him. There is something unique about that system of revealed truth committed to the Apostle Paul. So we looked at some passages that demonstrate how unique this gospel is. And then, of course, we spent a little bit of time looking at the content of that gospel. What Paul is doing is orienting the believer to the whole system of grace, which is founded upon what Jesus Christ did for us on the cross of Calvary. Paul is the one who provides the rich, deep meaning of the death, burial, and resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ. Okay, so the establishment design. To be firmly fixed, we need to understand something about this gospel. Okay, now we're moving on. He says there in verse 25, not only to establish you according to my gospel. Remember the idea of according, that is, we are to conform and adhere. And that's the idea. When the verse talks about according to something, hey, we have to adhere to this standard. And this is God's standard of establishment or establishment. Not only will we be properly established according to my gospel, now Paul's going to refer to what he calls, verse 25, the preaching of Jesus Christ, according, there's that standard, to the revelation of the mystery. Now he's going to define mystery for us, by the way, which was kept secret since the world began. Kind of interesting. The verse does not say which was secret. It was kept secret. God deliberately did something to keep it secret. We'll say some things about that next Sunday morning. So we're now looking at this next level of spiritual edification, the next level which will result in the believer being established. The first thing we want to note is that we're not preaching a theology, we're not preaching a theological system per se. According to verse 25, it's the preaching of Jesus Christ, and that is critically important. When verse 25 tells us the preaching of Jesus Christ, some interpret that to mean the things that Jesus preached. You see how you could read it that way? It's the preaching of Jesus Christ in the sense of what is it that Jesus Christ preached and taught? It's not a reference to the ministry conducted by the Lord Jesus. When the verse talks about the preaching of Jesus Christ, it's talking about preaching the person. It's the proclamation of Jesus Christ, okay? Not what he preached. And that's critically important to understand, because Jesus Christ was not sent but to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. He had a unique ministry as the minister of the circumcision. He came unto his own, the nation of Israel. He conducted a ministry according to the flesh. So the preaching of Jesus, that is, the information Jesus preached and taught, has nothing to do with the church, the body of Christ, in any direct application. Paul's talking about preaching Jesus in a new and different way, teaching something about the Lord Jesus Christ, which is different from the way the Lord Jesus was preached in time past. And for that matter, the way Jesus as a person is going to be proclaimed in the future. That's what right division does, okay? So when we're looking at the issue of preaching Jesus Christ, we're not preaching, obviously, his earthly ministry. We're not preaching information regarding the prophetic purpose of Messiah and a literal Davidic kingdom to be established on the earth. And by the way, preaching Jesus Christ isn't just preaching the cross either. Paul says, as we read the verse, the preaching of Jesus Christ according to the revelation of the mystery, not according to the gospel or according to the cross. Preaching Jesus in a very new and unique way. Okay, now, how do we preach the person of Jesus Christ? Verse 25, the preaching of Jesus Christ according to the revelation of the mystery. That's how we preach Jesus Christ. We preach Jesus in a new way. We preach some things about the Lord Jesus Christ in relationship to eternity. Okay? And that's what Paul's getting at, especially as we begin to look at, well, what exactly is this revelation of the mystery? Now, the word mystery, it has nothing to do with intelligence. It has nothing to do with being initiated. There's a large element in the ranks of Christendom when they come across the word mystery, you know, the Greek word mysterion. And what that means is, well, only the initiated had any understanding regarding this information. Well, what do you mean? What they mean is this, that there were people in history that did have some knowledge, some awareness, some understanding of Jesus Christ, and oftentimes they're talking about the crucifixion. So when they use or they interpret the idea of a mystery, they believe that not everybody had access to it. This information was not available to the general public, that God specifically limited this information to select individuals through history. That's not what the mystery is about. It isn't just information that God randomly selected a few individuals to reveal. The idea being that, you know, perhaps King David was the initiated and he understood some things, right? And again, it has nothing to do with intelligence. That is, well, preaching Jesus according to this revelation of the mystery, you know, he's hard to understand. Sometimes it's just difficult to comprehend. Again, that isn't what the mystery is in the Bible, specifically in Paul's epistles, okay? So let's just talk about, well, what is the mystery. How do we define mystery? It has nothing to do with IQ. It has nothing to do with God randomly selecting individuals in the past, letting them know about it, but keeping it suppressed from the masses, okay? The verse already gives us a clue of what a mystery is. At the very end of verse 25, notice, which was kept secret since the world began. So this mystery was something that was kept. Again, it was deliberately suppressed. It was kept secret. So the word mystery has something to do with a secret. Okay? A couple of verses, 1 Corinthians chapter 2. 1 Corinthians chapter 2. And here are some verses that will help define the word mystery. It is a system of information that God deliberately kept secret. And we're going to see God kept it hidden in himself, and he kept it hidden from all humanity, from generations and from ages. All right? Nobody knew this secret except God. Okay? 1 Corinthians chapter 2. If we pick it up there at verse 7, look at 1 Corinthians 2, verse 7. But we speak the wisdom of God in a mystery, even the hidden wisdom. Now, that verse sheds a little bit of light. What is a mystery? It's hidden wisdom. Romans 16 says it was kept secret. That's the idea of hiding it. Now, some critics will say, well, yeah, God kept it hidden from the unbelievers. You see, if you resist right division, if you reject God's method of rightly dividing the word of truth, which means you reject dispensationalism, you're forced to begin to read into these passages things that just simply are not there. When the verse here talks about hidden wisdom, is it suggesting that it's hidden from the unbeliever? You see, does it say anything about God hiding it from unbelievers? Because if you're a critic of dispensationalism, that's the only way you're going to be able to handle this verse, wrongly handling God's word. So if we let the verses just say what they say, we discover, wait a minute, it's not hidden from the unbeliever, it's hidden, period. And we'll see another verse that'll shed light on that. Verse 7, but we speak the wisdom of God in a mystery, even the hidden wisdom which God ordained before the world. I love this one. Unto whose glory? This sacred secret has a direct correlation with our eternal destiny. Put it this way. God kept it hidden because of you and me. Now, you ever think about that? Now, we understand, and certainly verse 8, which none of the princes of this world knew, for had they known it, they would not have crucified the Lord of glory. Yes, there is the truth that God kept it hidden in himself in light of what the satanic policy of evil was doing in trying to and ultimately having Christ Jesus crucified. But it's fascinating that what Paul is emphasizing at the end of verse 7 is that this secret, this hidden wisdom, has a direct correlation with our eternal glory. God kept it secret for our benefit. Now, there are a number of reasons why. One reason he kept it secret was for our benefit. Critically important. Go over to Ephesians chapter 3. As again, we're trying to get a feel for the concept, the definition of this mystery. Ephesians chapter 3. And notice there in verse 5. Ephesians chapter 3, verse 5. Well, tell you what, let's read verses 1 through 5, all right? It does us well to look at the context. Ephesians 1, chapter 3, verse 1. For this cause I, Paul, the prisoner of Jesus Christ, for you Gentiles, if ye have heard of the dispensation of the grace of God, which is given me to you. You see how Paul personalizes this? Remember what we said about my gospel? The only one that ever says this. Mine, entrusted to me, my possession. I have sole ownership. Paul isn't some megalomaniac. He isn't some egotistical, you know. And you know what? I have read commentaries written by men with theological degrees who actually believe that Paul had an ego problem. Now, you think about, first of all, they obviously have a low view of Scripture. I mean, I hope you have a high view of Scripture. It's the words right out of the mouth and mind of Almighty God. So when Paul starts talking about himself, if you understand that this is eternally preserved as God's word, breathed by Almighty God. See, God is the one who allowed Paul to call it my gospel. And when Paul says the dispensation of the grace of God, which is given me, it has nothing to do with Paul's personal. And so again, you have many, you have theologians that have such a low view of God's word. Verse 3, how that by revelation he made known unto me the, what? Mystery, the hidden wisdom. The hidden wisdom which was packaged and designed for our ultimate glory, our eternal destiny. Verse 4, whereby when ye read, ye may understand my knowledge in the mystery of Christ. Now look at verse 5, which in other ages was not made known unto the sons of men. Now, that's pretty clear, right? Was there any human being before the Apostle Paul that had any clue, any awareness, any understanding of this hidden wisdom? No. The verse says, which in other ages was not made known unto the sons of men. So this is what the critic will argue. Keep reading verse 5. As it is now revealed unto his holy apostles and prophets by the Spirit. You see, what the verse supposedly is saying is that package of information, the sacred secret, the hidden wisdom, this revelation of the mystery, it just wasn't made known back then as it's being made known today. You see how you can interpret the idea of as? Read verse 5 again. Which in other ages was not made known unto the sons of men as it is now revealed. You see, it was revealed in the past in a different way. Now that's what the critic is going to argue, right? In other words, you see the as? They use the as a comparison. In other words, for example, if I say, you know, Israel didn't have cell phones as we do today. Now, there are two ways of interpreting it, right? Well, yeah, they didn't have cell phones as we do today because, you know, they didn't have the smartphone. They had the old dumb phone. That's one way of interpreting it, right? See, if I say Israel didn't have cell phones as we did today, I could imply they did have cell phones, but they're different than the ones we have today, where they can follow you around all over the world. You know, the GPS and all that kind of stuff, you know. You know, that's why I'm off the grid, right? So now that is how the critic of dispensationalism will interpret verse 5. Oh, no, right. It wasn't known in a general way. It was known in a different way, but it was knowable. But wait a minute. Paul isn't using the as a comparison. He's using it as a contrast. So if I say Israel did not have cell phones as we do today, what am I saying? They had no such thing as a cell phone thousands of years ago. You see, what Paul is saying is, in verse 5, when which in other ages was not made known unto the sons of men, as it, this is an as of contrast. No one understood any of this because it was hidden. Where was it kept secret? Drop down to verse 11. I'm sorry, verse 9. And to make all men see what is the fellowship of the mystery, which from the beginning of the world hath been hid in who? God. Amen. What the passages are teaching is really simple. If you reject dispensationalism, now things become a little more complicated because all of a sudden the passages aren't fitting the theological paradigm. So that's why you have the critic. Oh, yeah, it's not made known to the unbeliever. Or it's made known, but not in the same way it's being made known today. Paul keeps emphasizing God is the only one who possessed this information, and he kept it secret, and it's hidden in him. And if it's hidden in him, it is not made known unto the sons of men. It just was not revealed to any human being prior to the Apostle Paul. And that's the point that Paul is making. Another passage in this regard, go to Colossians chapter 1. Colossians chapter 1. And Paul is going to reiterate that fact as he writes to the saints at Colossae, Colossians chapter 1. And look there at verse 24, Colossians 1 verse 24. Who now rejoice in my sufferings for you and fill up that which is behind of the afflictions of Christ in my flesh for his body's sake, which is the church, whereof I am made a minister according to, again, conforming to a standard, according to the dispensation of God, which is given to me for you to fulfill the word of God, even the mystery which hath been hid from ages and from generations. When we take this verse with Ephesians 3 verse 5, God says, it's not revealed to men. It has not been revealed in the ages. It was not revealed to any generation. Period. Ephesians 3, 9. It was hid in God and God alone. That's what the verses teach. Verse 26, even the mystery which hath been hid from generations, from ages and from generations, but now is made manifest to his what? Saints. Remember, Paul, my gospel, my dispensation. It's been the dispensation of grace which is committed to me. It is now being made manifest. Not in comparison to the way he did, but in contrast, because it was never, ever revealed before. And it has something to do with our glory. You talk about a loving Father who loves us that dearly and that deeply. God deliberately kept it secret so that we can enjoy eternal glory with him. We're going to share in that glory. And now, I know when we conclude the book, when Paul says, to God only wise be glory, that's what he's dealing with, our eternal destiny, okay? So, this is what I want to do now. Wait, you're saying that God kept a secret. Well, first of all, am I saying God kept a secret? Paul, the author of inspired God himself, is pressing the glorious truth that he has a right to keep something hidden. God has the right to keep a secret. And he did keep it a secret. And it wasn't made known to any human being. It wasn't made known in the ages. It wasn't made known to as it is now being made manifest. The concept of keeping a secret. Some are just aghast. You mean God now is just ushering a brand new program and purpose and dispensation and a new message and a new gospel and a new apostle and a new purpose? Yeah. And how can you say that? You know, people, theologians, they teach that, oh, there's just been this one continuum, this one unbroken purpose and program of Almighty God. Listen, God has kept secrets. So anyone who would reject what we here at Shorewood, for example, would teach regarding dispensationalism, they have to struggle with the fact that the Bible teaches clearly God not only has the right to keep information hidden himself, but he actually has done it before. Now let's run. Before we go to Deuteronomy, There is something in theology called the doctrine of intercalation. And by the way, it isn't just limited to theology. There are other sciences that understand this concept of intercalation. Now, don't get frightened. Intercalation. Calendar. Intercalendar. Simply, the doctrine of intercalation, or calation, however you want to pronounce it, or if you want to pronounce it, doctrine of intercalation, intercalendar. So think about that for a second. Inserting into the calendar. You see the word intercalation? In other words, the doctrine of intercalation recognizes and understands that there can be, and oftentimes is, a layer of time inserted, let's say, in a calendar. The idea is this. It recognizes that there are intervals of time in the Bible. There are intervals of time in a calendar that you can insert. Not because we fabricate these gaps, by the way, dare I say, or dare I call it a gap. I can call it a gap. Not to say that we make up these gaps in history or make up these interval of times, but when we study Scripture, we begin to learn that God can and has inserted gaps in His Word. So let's first of all recognize there is such a thing as intercalation. Because the greatest gap in human history is the dispensation of grace. Okay? So let's go to Deuteronomy 29, and just understand that when it comes to God and His right to keep a secret, don't be stunned. I don't understand why some, they so vehemently reject the idea that what we're experiencing today is an administrative program, a dispensational system that God kept hidden in Himself, and then it was first revealed to Paul. Why should anybody freak out? God has done something similar in the past. So why should we reject the idea of an entire dispensation being a secret? Paul says, to God only wise. Wow. God in His supreme genius kept it hidden in Himself. Deuteronomy chapter 29, verse 29. Deuteronomy 29, verse 29. The secret things belong unto the who? The Lord. Now, outside of the context, are there some secret things that God says, I possess? I mean, again, verse 20, the secret things belong unto the Lord, our God. But those things which are what? So, do you see the contrast here? There's a difference between secret things and things that are what? Revealed. The secret things, that means by default, it isn't revealed. Otherwise, it's not a secret. So, think about the language Paul is using. Hidden wisdom. Not made known unto the sons of men, not made known to the ages and to generations. Interesting. We're preaching the person of Jesus Christ according to the revelation of the mystery, which was kept secret. You see, the concept already is established in here in Deuteronomy, at least. We already are confronted with this capacity of God to possess a secret, which is different than revealing things. Read verse 29. The secret things belong unto the Lord our God, but those things which are revealed belong unto us and to our children forever, that we may do all the words of this law. You know what Moses is writing? He's saying, listen, what God has revealed to us has a purpose, and we're going to reveal it to our kids, but maybe, perhaps, there are some things God has chosen not to reveal. So already in Deuteronomy, we are confronted with at least the possibility of God keeping something secret. Has God kept information secret? Go to Daniel chapter 2. Daniel chapter 2. And we're going to see how the doctrine of intercalation or calation, that intercalation, by the way, the book of Daniel is the best example of recognizing this intercalation view, okay? Daniel chapter 2. And when we go to Daniel chapter 2, let's read there. And you know, I hope we don't need to go through what's happening in Daniel, right? Nebuchadnezzar has this image of the Colossus and so on and so forth, right? So Daniel chapter 2, verse 18. Daniel 2, verse 18. That they would desire mercies of the God of heaven concerning this what? Secret. Well, yeah, okay. So, you know, Nebuchadnezzar, he ate a lot of Italian food late at night, and now he's got a lot of heartburn, and he's laying in his bed, and now he's having nightmares. And so now, poor Nebuchadnezzar, you know, there's information, and there's this dream, and he just doesn't understand. Now, wait a minute. Who planted that dream into the mind of Nebuchadnezzar? See, when Daniel's going to refer to it as a secret, it isn't just Nebuchadnezzar is confused and he doesn't understand what's going on. So now God says, oh, Daniel, we got to help this poor guy out. God is doing something for Israel's benefit because Israel, by the way, is in Babylonian captivity. So what does God do? He plants a dream into Nebuchadnezzar. But Daniel calls it a secret. Because what God is going to do is reveal a secret. Now, let's keep reading. Verse 18. That they would desire mercies of the God of heaven concerning this secret, that Daniel and his fellows should not perish with the rest of the wise men of Babylon. Then was the secret revealed unto who? Okay, who's going to reveal the secret to Daniel? Ultimately, it's God. Well, wait a minute. Did God exercise the right to have a secret? Forget what it is. We'll look at what it is exactly. Does God reserve the right to have a secret? Absolutely. We're going to learn for the first time in all of human history, via the instrumentality of Daniel, God is now going to reveal something that he already knew, he kept hidden, and for the first time, he's going to reveal it to who? Daniel. Question. Can God do the same thing with a man whom we now know as Paul, who used to be Saul of Tarsus? Can God also keep information hidden and then choose to reveal it to Saul of Tarsus? He did it with Daniel. So my point is this. The concept of God keeping information hidden in himself is nothing new. We're witnessing it here in the book of Daniel. So here, well, what exactly is going on here? Look at verse 22. Look at verse 22. He revealeth the deep and secret things. Now, there's some things regarding Satan and so forth. We're not going to get into the weeds here. But verse 22, he revealeth the deep and secret things. He knoweth what is in the darkness, and the light dwelleth with him. This verse is saying God understands what Satan's trying to do here. But nonetheless, we're talking about what did God do with Nebuchadnezzar, and what is God now going to reveal to Daniel about the dream that Nebuchadnezzar had? In short, if you study Daniel chapter 2, especially really beginning from verse 18 all the way down to verse 47, let's go to verse 47. We're not going to read all these verses, okay? In your own study, read verses 18 through verse 47. Verse 47, the king answered unto Daniel and said, of a truth it is that your God is a God of gods and a Lord of kings and a revealer of secrets, seeing thou couldst reveal this secret. Remember, Nebuchadnezzar doesn't know what's going on. Daniel doesn't know what's going on, but God is the one who planted the dream in Nebuchadnezzar's mind, and God is the one who's going to now reveal the meaning behind it. Okay? What is the secret that Daniel, for the first time, is learning about. Israel is in captivity, and the secret that God is revealing is that Israel is going to be under Gentile dominion. It's called the times of the Gentiles before the kingdom of heaven is established. Think of it this way. God keeps telling Israel, I'm going to establish my kingdom. And it's going to be through the seed of David and through his loins. And I'm going to raise up the Messiah, the anointed. So Daniel, he's confused. They're in Babylonian captivity. But the problem is they're still in Babylonian captivity. And Israel's hope is, where's the kingdom? So you know what God's going to do? I'm going to reveal a secret to you, Daniel. Israel will always be under Gentile oppression. It's called the times of the Gentiles before the Lord Jesus comes and establishes his kingdom. That was never revealed before. Can we, we don't have any room. What Daniel does, it now inserts a gap, a layer of information, a layer of time in Israel's prophetic program that Israel didn't know about. All they knew was there's going to be captivity and then there's supposed to be a kingdom. How long has the times of the Gentiles now been operating? Now, prophetically, it operated for quite a while. But Jesus, when he comes back, he's going to destroy all of the Gentile dominion. That was a secret. Who before Daniel knew anything about the times of the Gentiles? When before the book of Daniel can we now insert in the calendar this gap of revealed information? Wait a minute. God did this in the past. He inserted a layer of time that as far before Daniel, nobody knew any of this information. You see what's going on? Here's another example of intercalation. Go to Matthew chapter 13. So the book of Daniel, and we're going to go back to Daniel, by the way, because we're going to also recognize a few other things. So wait a minute. God can keep a secret, and can he choose when and to whom he's going to reveal that information to? Yes, he did it with Daniel. Okay? The Lord Jesus does the same thing. Now, notice what the Lord Jesus is doing. In Matthew chapter 12, what's happening in Matthew chapter 12 is the Lord Jesus Christ is being rejected, okay? His identity is rejected. Israel, the national leadership, they're rejecting the Lord Jesus, okay? So the Lord Jesus Christ, in response to Israel's rejection of him, he now alters his teaching methodology. What he's going to do in Matthew 13 is begin to use parables, okay? So when we come to Matthew chapter 13, the Lord is going to begin to use these parables. Matthew chapter 13, verse 11. He answered and said unto them, because it is given unto you to know the mysteries of the kingdom of heaven. Wait a minute. Is Jesus going to teach some mysteries? So you see the word mysteries. Don't confuse the mysteries with what Paul calls the mystery. The Lord Jesus now is going to reveal some information that wasn't previously revealed. And don't get me wrong, there is information that was knowable that Israel unfortunately didn't know. But we're not dealing with that. What is Jesus Christ now going to do, especially here in Matthew 13? Drop down to verse 35, Matthew chapter 13 and verse 35. That it might be fulfilled which was spoken by the prophet, saying, I will open my mouth in parables. I will utter things which have been kept secret from the foundation of the world. You know what Jesus Christ is going to do now? In response to his rejection, he turns to the little flock. Jesus Christ, from this point on, he's now going to deal with Israel in regards to his delayed return. the Lord is now going to reveal details about the end times. It wasn't revealed before. Can God exercise his right, his prerogative, to keep some information to himself and then decide when and to whom he's going to reveal that information to? He's doing it again. He did it with Daniel. He's doing it again in Matthew 13. Real quickly, there are seven secrets concerning the kingdom. The seven secrets concerning the kingdom has everything to do with the Lord's delay in returning. Now, there's a parallel with Daniel. Remember Daniel. Captivity, kingdom. Captivity, kingdom. Why are we still in captivity? Where's the kingdom? What does God reveal? Daniel, intercalation. There is going to be a period of time where Israel will suffer under Gentile oppression. It's the times of the Gentiles. Nobody knew that before. God's revealing it. Here's Jesus. He's now preparing his disciples for his rejection, for his absence. And as he prepares his disciples, he's telling them, I'm not coming back right away. There are things that are going to happen prior to my return. There are seven secrets regarding the impending kingdom, and what Jesus begins to do is describe things that are going to happen previous, immediately before his return. Things that are going to happen in the tribulation. Things that are happening in the last days. That's what these seven mysteries are all about. Jesus is telling the disciples some things that, hey, wait a minute. I don't want anybody else to know about it, but I'm going to let you know about it. Go back to Daniel, the idea of intercalation. Now this, to me, again, is so painfully obvious. Why is it important to recognize this? Because when God chooses to reveal an entire dispensational program, you cannot cry, this is unheard of. God's already demonstrated his capacity to do something like that. Going back to Daniel, and let's go to Daniel chapter 2 again. Go to Daniel chapter 2. And notice Daniel chapter 2 and verse 32. Daniel chapter 2, verse 32. Verse 32. This image's head was of fine gold, his breast and his arms of silver, his belly and his thighs of brass. Now, if you study Daniel, we discover the gold represents Babylon. The silver represents Media Persia. The belly and the thighs represents Greece. Look at verse 33. His legs of iron, his feet part of iron and part of clay. For you Bible students, what is verse 33 referring to? It's referring to the kingdom of Antichrist. Question. Is there a period of time between verse 32 and verse 33? There has to be. We're in that period of time. Do you see that intercalation? Insert in the calendar. There is an interval of time. Here's the point. There is time between verse 32 and verse 33. Verse 32 is the past. Verse 33 is the future. Well, isn't there something going on in between those two verses? Did God just turn off the lights and just took a nap? Listen, there are things that are happening between those two verses. In fact, we find ourselves, we find the dispensation of grace, we now know, in between those two verses. Go over to verse 38. Go to verse 38. Verse 38. Let's read verse 39. Well, okay, verse 38. Read verse 38. And wheresoever the children of men dwell, the beasts of the field and the fowls of the heaven hath he given into thine hand, and hath made thee ruler over them all. Thou art the head of gold. Verse 39. And after thee shall arise another kingdom inferior to thee, and another third kingdom of brass, which shall bear rule over all the earth. That's already happened. Babylon, Media, Persia, and Greece. Look at verse 40. And the fourth kingdom shall be as strong as iron, For as much as iron breaketh in pieces and subdueth all things, and as iron that breaketh all these, shall it break in pieces and bruise. Verse 40 is the kingdom of Antichrist. Question, is there a period of time between verses 39 and verse 40? What's going on? Verse 39 passed. Verse 40, not only is it future to Daniel, it's future to you and me. So intercalation demands there's a gap. There's something happening in between. Now, we know what's going on in between when we study other passages of Scripture. Go to chapter 7. Look there at chapter 7. Daniel does this over and over again. Interestingly enough, in light of God who is a revealer of secrets. Daniel chapter 7, and look there at verse 6. Daniel 7, verse 6. After this I beheld, and lo, another like a leopard, that's Greece, by the way, which had upon the back of it four wings of a fowl. Remember how historically Greece was divided into four kingdoms, north, south, east, west? I can't remember their names. I got it written down here somewhere. Those four Greek generals. Alexander the Great, and so on and so forth. So that's what verse 6 is describing, okay? I beheld the leopard, which had upon the back of it four wings of a fowl. The beast had also four heads, and dominion was given to it. Well, that's already happened. Look at verse 7. After this I saw in the night visions, and behold, a fourth beast, dreadful and terrible and strong exceedingly, and it had great iron teeth. It devoured and brake in pieces and stamped the residue at the feet of it. And it was diverse from all the beasts that were before it. And it had 10 horns. 10. You know, you see what it's got? The 10 toes. You know, is there a gap between verse 6 and verse 7? There's a gap. Intercalation. Go over to chapter 8. Chapter 8. Over and over and over again. Chapter 8. And we have it in here at verse 8. Daniel 8, 8. Therefore, the he-goat waxed very great. And when he was strong, the great horn was broken. And for it came up four notable ones towards the four winds of heaven. That's the past. Look at verse 9. And out of one of them came forth a little horn. That's going to be the Antichrist and the kingdom, his kingdom. Is there an interval of time between verses 8 and 9? There has to be. We're in it. Drop down to verse 22. Now that, being broken, whereas four stood up for it, four kingdoms shall stand up out of the nation, but not in his power. Verse 23. And in the latter time of their kingdom, when the transgressors are come to the full, a king of fierce countenance and understanding. That's the Antichrist. Here's the point. What Daniel is demonstrating, what God is revealing to Daniel, which was never revealed before. By the way, who before Daniel knew anything about the division of the times of the Gentiles? No one. Did God keep that information in himself and choose at his own volition to whom and when he's going to reveal it? Yes. And what Daniel is describing is, yeah, you look at history from our perspective. You look at history and you have Alexander the Great. You have the fourfold division. What we know is this. The Antichrist is going to come out of one of the branches of that divided kingdom. For those of you who are with us in the book of, when we studied the book of Revelation, that's the area of Turkey. I mean, you look at, if you want to know where Antichrist is coming from, it's coming from that fourth division of the Greek Empire, and that has to do with that region that the Bible calls Magog. That's going to be, here's my map, you've got Turkey, you've got northern Syria, northern Iraq, northern Iran, that whole area right there. That was part of the fourth kingdom of Greece, out of which arises Antichrist. Question, where are we in the dispensation? We're tucked snug as a bug between verse 22 and verse 23. You see why we got to recognize intercalation? We now can insert a period of time. And then go to Daniel chapter 9. Look at this one. Now, this is Daniel chapter 9. Of course, we're familiar with verse 25, Daniel 9, verse 25. Know therefore and understand that from the going forth of the commandment to restore and build the Jerusalem unto the Messiah, the Prince, shall be 7 weeks. Already happened. Okay, that's just history past. And 62 weeks, and the street shall be built again, and the wall, even in troublous times. That's already happened. History past. Now look at verse 26. And after 62 weeks shall Messiah be cut off. Already happened. History past. But not for himself. And the people of the prince. Huh. Who's this? That shall come shall destroy the city and the sanctuary, and the end thereof shall be with a flood. And unto the end of the war, desolations are determined, and he shall confirm the covenant with many for 1 week. Uh-oh. You know, when we apply the doctrine of intercalation, go back to verse 26. And after 62 weeks shall Messiah be cut off, already done, but not for himself. Colon. And the people of the prince that shall come. That's still the future. You understand that at that colon, you now can insert a period of time? In one verse, you have things that have already happened, and then God immediately bypasses at least 2,000 years. We now know it as the dispensation of grace. And Daniel starts talking about the Antichrist in one verse. Go to chapter 11, one more in Daniel, chapter 11, Daniel chapter 11, and look there at verse 4, Daniel 11, verse 4. And when he shall stand up, his kingdom shall be broken and shall be divided toward the four winds of heaven, again, the fourfold division of Greece, and not to his own posterity, nor according to his dominion which he ruled, for his kingdom shall be plucked up even for others besides those. It's all past. Verse 5, and the king of the south shall be strong, and one of his princes, and he be that's now the future. Again, we can insert, rightly insert, a period of time between verse 4 and verse 5. Again, what am I getting at? The dispensation of the grace of God is a period of time unheard of, unknown, never revealed, that we now know about because it was first revealed to and through the Apostle Paul, and it's in keeping with a very typical way in which God has dealt with humanity. I don't have to tell you everything, and nor did he tell everybody everything. And when he does, hey, wait a minute, there are things that are happening in history. The greatest gap in history is the dispensation of grace. I want to go to Psalms chapter 2. Go to Psalms chapter 2. A couple of more verses just to demonstrate that this is a very common way of God dealing with his people. Psalms chapter 2. Look at Psalms chapter 2, verse 7. Psalms chapter 2, verse 7. I will declare the decree. The Lord has said unto me, this is the Father talking to the Son, the Lord Jesus, thou art my Son, this day have I begotten thee. Has verse 7 been fulfilled? Yes, according to Acts chapter 13. When did God the Father say, concerning his Son, thou art my Son, this day have I begotten thee? According to Acts 13, verse 33, that was his resurrection. In other words, verse 7, it's already occurred. But look at verse 8. Ask of me, and I shall give thee the heathen for thine inheritance, and the uttermost parts for the earth for thy possession. Thou shalt break them with the rod of iron. Thou shalt dash them in pieces like a potter's vessel. Has that happened yet? Why not? Because of the grace of Almighty God. Here's the point. Is there a gap between verses 7 and verse 8 and 9? There has to be. And we now know we're in that gap, okay? Don't get me wrong, there's also a prophetic gap there. But you got my point here, right? Go to chapter 22, Psalms chapter 22. And notice there in Psalms chapter 22. Psalms 22 and verse 21. Now, verses 1 through verse 21 describes in intimate detail the experience of our Lord and Savior on the cross. Verse 21, save me from the lion's mouth, for thou hast heard me from the horns of the unicorns. Now look at verse 22. I will declare thy name unto my brethren. In the midst of the congregation will I praise thee. Verse 22 and following hasn't happened yet. According to Hebrews chapter 2, verse 22 and following has not happened yet. One day, when Jesus comes back in his glory, verse 22, I will declare thy name unto my brethren. In the midst of the congregation will I praise thee. According to Hebrews, you know what Hebrews is saying to the little flock? Just as Jesus Christ the Messiah was raised from the dead, you know what Jesus is going to do for his little flock? He's going to raise them up as well. And they're all going to praise God when Jesus is functioning as the rightful ruler and king on planet Earth. My point is this. There is a gap between verse 21 and verse 22. So, I can give you more Isaiah. Now, takes a little bit of study. Genesis chapter 1 and verse 1 and 2. That's another gap. In the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth. How much time transpires? And the earth was without form and void, and darkness upon the face of the deep. When we study other passages of Scripture, we learn. You see how God forces us to study? And God says, you know, study to show thyself what? Approved. You see, we don't just read Genesis chapter 1, verses 1 and 2 and say, oh, when you start reading other, all of a sudden, wait a minute, there's information over here that fits between verses 1 and 2. Just like in the book of Daniel, just like in the book of Isaiah, just like in the book of Psalms. You see how God, it's a very common technique. Okay, after saying all of that, let's go back to Romans chapter 16. Romans chapter 16. We need to understand, what does the mystery mean? Please, it's something God can keep personally hidden in himself and reveal at his own choosing and reveal to whom he decides to reveal. He did it before. Guess what he did? He did it again. Now, there is a difference between secrets within a dispensation and a dispensation being a secret. And that's what Paul is all about. It's not secrets within a dispensation. It's a dispensation which got to God only wise. He kept an entire dispensational program a secret. There are six questions, you know, remember in school, who, what, where, when, why, and how. When it comes to the secret, when it comes to the mystery, who is it about? Well, verse 25, it's the preaching of who? Jesus Christ. We'll pick this up next time. We're going to stop. Number one, who is it about? It's about Jesus Christ. We're going to learn something about the Lord Jesus in a new role. Now, theology, they go ballistic. See, they believe, well, you believe in a different Jesus. Listen, it's the same Jesus Christ. It's the same person. What the revelation of the mystery does, it presents the Lord Jesus Christ in a new role. The mystery about Jesus, it's about the Lord Jesus in eternity. Not a mystery about what he did on the cross, not a mystery about his person, not a mystery about his being. It's the proclamation of Jesus. It's the preaching of the person in a new undisclosed role. That's what the preaching of Jesus Christ according to Revelation of the mystery is all about. It's proclaiming him in the way the Father is now making him known. Prophetically, Jesus can only be known as the rightful Messiah. According to the mystery, we know him in an entirely different role. Not as a Messiah to establish governmental authority and supreme rule and reign on the earth as promised to David, but now we're learning about something else that's happening in the cosmos. Number two, what is it about? Next week we'll look at who's it about. Secondly, what is it about? And then we're going to look at, well, where is it? And then we're going to look at when was it revealed? And then we're going to look at, well, why was it kept secret in the first place? And then ultimately, when we this epistle, verse 27, how can it be? Paul tells us how it can be: to God only wise. You know, critics of dispensationalism, critics of us, because we rightly divide the word of truth, our hobby horse, our hang-up, our heresy, our cult-like following. You know what we find out in Paul's epistles? It is near and dear to the heart of Almighty God. His glory is at stake. It may not be important to our brethren that are caught up in the religious, traps, but it's important to God. This information glorifies God in a very special way. So to poo-poo it because it violates your theology is irrelevant. It magnifies God Almighty. Father, we thank you again for your love, your grace, your goodness. We thank you for all that you have revealed, especially through the Apostle Paul and certainly now unto us by way of Scripture. We thank you, Lord, that we can know your mind. We can know the very mind of Christ. We can just glorify you because of this manifold wisdom that you now have made known to your people. We pray, Lord, that we would always be skillful and careful in our study, certainly as we apply the principle of right division. And as we do so, may our Savior be rightly honored and glorified as the head of this entity, the church, and as the preeminent one, not only on the earth, but preeminent in and through the heavenly places. May we hold him in the same place of esteem that you hold your beloved Son. And we ask it, of course, in Christ Jesus.